hymns or carols that we're used to singing on Christmas. We just bow your heads, please. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you would be with us. That Holy Spirit, you would not just fill this space, but that you would fill our hearts. And that whether this is the first time or the 80th time we've celebrated Christmas, that once again we're able to glance into that manger and see something that we never saw before. Some depth, some deeper meaning, some greater understanding of what it is you accomplished on this day. And so, Father, be with us as we worship. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So everything that you need is going to be on the screen above my head. Would you please just now stand up, say hi to each other, give a high five or a hug, and then stay standing for the first two songs. Two, right? Or one? Two, one. How many? Heavenly Father, once again, we praise and thank you that you've brought us into this place and that we might worship you. Holy Spirit, turn this place into a sanctuary, a place where the craziness of the world we can leave behind for a few moments and spend some time with you. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for becoming one of us. Thank you for making you, God, tangible. A God we could touch and hear and who could touch us. Thank you for taking on flesh. We worship you, Holy Trinity. In Jesus' name, amen. We're having communion today, so stay standing for a second, and we're going to say together Psalm 130 as our confession. So let's say these words together. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than the watchmen wait for the morning. O Israel, put your hope in the Lord. For with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can, as broken, sinful individuals, crawl to the cross and once again hear the words to tell us, it's finished, the price is paid. That there is nothing that we can do to make you love us any less than you do right now. Father, you love us, and we can't affect that. We can't make that decline by our sin. We can't make it incline by our righteousness because you love us profoundly and deeply. And because of that unfailing love, you take our sins and you throw them as far as the east is from the west and you remember them no more. And we thank you that this is why Jesus came. And we pray in his name. Amen. Please be seated. Our reading for today is the same reading that we had yesterday. It is the Luke chapter 2, the very traditional Christmas event. So here, as Elder Tim reads from Luke chapter 2. This is the word of the Lord. Let's sing our message song. Youth worship team, boom. Nice job. Nice job. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts. May they be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. The text that I'd like to base some thoughts on with you are from Luke chapter 2, verse 19. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. We're going to talk about treasuring and pondering for a few minutes. I had a chance at the women's event at the manger to have spent some time talking about this very idea. When you read this verse and you hear Luke describe that Mary treasured these things and pondered them in her heart, you have to get there. You got to get your feet on the ground. This is probably a 17, 18, 19-year-old girl. I mean, who has the wisdom to treasure things and ponder things at that age? You see, when God starts to do things in your life, I look back at my life and I wonder how many things I've missed But she learned so early in life to grab a hold of them and to ponder them and to think about them. I mean, certainly she went through some amazing things. I mean, things that you and I obviously will never go through, but that same God has done some pretty amazing things in our lives too. Any of you watch that show, television show, This Is Us? Anybody? It's a pretty popular show, and Kimberly and I watch it when we can. It's a combined story of a family, a husband and wife who have triplets, but one of them passes away at the hospital shortly after birth, and then there was this other family who had a child, and they gave that child up, and through the doctor or whatever, that child was brought into the family of triplets, a white family with one black child. And then simultaneously, you bounce back and forth between their lives as kids growing up and their lives as adults. Well, one of the characters that we get introduced to is William. William is the black father who, with his girlfriend at the time, gave up their child. And in miraculous, crazy ways, William has been reintroduced to his child and now his grandchildren many, many years later. And William is dying. He's got cancer. And so his son is wrestling with the father who gave him up and the father that he's now being introduced to and the father that is dying. And I just want you to get the picture. There is this scene a show or two ago where they're all getting together for Christmas. They're getting prepared to get ready for Christmas, and William goes out on the porch because he's just kind of overwhelmed by everything that he's experiencing. And this young, late 20, maybe early 30s woman goes out there because she's frustrated. She doesn't like what's happening, and she's mad at her boyfriend, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And she asks, out of the blue, the most crazy question to William. What's it like to be dying? I mean, the question just bit at me. It was so insensitive. It was so, I don't know, inappropriate. And then William says, I'm beginning to ponder the moments when I take my grandchildren and I have permission to lay them down to sleep. I just stare at them and I watch every breath and I take everything in, and I'm trying to memorize the smells and I'm trying to memorize the sight and I'm trying to memorize all of it, because soon there won't be any. But it seems that the older that I get, the faster the moments happen, and the faster that they go past, and the faster that everything happens, and they seem to be slipping through my fingers. And at 56, going on 57, way too late in my life, God has taught me how to ponder, how to treasure things up. And I just want to encourage you that this is something that we have to do. We have to learn how to see God in the moments. There was this sermon series that I preached some time ago about finding God in the sacred moments of our lives. Sometimes we're living life so fast. Sometimes we're moving so fast. Sometimes it's happening so fast that we don't see it. We don't see what God's doing. But Mary was wise enough to say, holy cow, something's happening, and I got to start. I can't figure this stuff out. There's no way in the world. I mean, the song that you just listened to, Mary, Did You Know? You could stop at every line and do like a series of sermons. Did you know that the child you delivered would soon deliver you? I mean, that tee that up for a pastor. That's months of sermons right there. Did you know? Could you wrap your mind around the fact that when you kiss that baby, you kiss the face of God? And then you quickly realize there's something so profound that you can ponder them for the rest of your life and not get them. They just overwhelm me. But there's one part of that song that's not too overwhelming. The blind will see. The dead will hear. The dead will live again. The lame will leap and the dumb will speak the praises of the I am. Brothers and sisters in Christ, on this Christmas morning, one of the questions that we have to ask is, does it matter that this Jesus was born? What difference does it make? I mean, yeah, it's pretty cool that he could stop a storm or walk on water. It's pretty cool to think that he had those abilities and he was all of that. But I don't know. Without the refrain, I don't have anything. If I don't know that he can touch my blind eyes and make me see truths that I never saw before, what do I do? If my ears are so deaf that I'm not hearing, only he can allow me to hear. What if I'm so handicapped? What if I'm so handicapped that I can't do what God's called me to do? Then somewhere he has to have the ability. Somewhere he has to step in and make blind eyes see and deaf ears hear. He has to make the lame person leap. He has to be able to take the dead and make it alive. And so you ponder. I think about the Gospel of Matthew, and I think about Matthew writing a genealogy about Jesus, and inside the genealogy, he throws in some Gentiles and sinners. He doesn't even call Bathsheba by name, and I say, Matthew, what are you doing? And Matthew says, well, I'm a Jew, and I'm writing to my Jewish brothers and sisters, and I'm trying to convince them that Jesus is the Messiah. Because sometimes we have such great pride in our lineage and our bloodline, we forget that it's tainted. And that even the lineage of Jesus was tainted. He had to be born of a virgin, had to be conceived by the Holy Spirit, so not to be tainted by what taints us. I've taken a lot of you through that wonderful verse in Matthew where it says, and there were 14 generations from Abraham to David and from David to the exile and the exile to Jesus, and only your pastor would go and count them all and go, wait a minute, how come in the last one there's only 13? I encourage you to do it. What is Matthew doing? Why is he saying there's 14 generations in each of the sections, but when you count them, there's only 13 in the last one? Matthew, what are you doing? And he says, listen, I'm telling every Jew to beg a question. Who did Jesus beget? And then chapter 2 of Matthew, he has Magi coming to worship him at age 2. You see, you and I are the new Israel.
How do you slow everything down so that you ponder these things, that you take them in? I mean, I know some of these things you can't grasp because maybe you don't know Greek and that kind of stuff, but man, it is really cool to listen to Matthew's genealogy and have him sitting there going, and Abraham, Agenison, Isaac, and Isaac, Agenison, Jacob, and Agenison, and then all of a sudden Mary, Agenethade. Not Agenison, but Agenethade, the first time in a Jewish lineage, a genealogy, where the woman begets, Mary begat, he uses feminine. Holy cow. Imagine those early writers trying to absorb and trying to contemplate and figure out what is it that we experienced and who is this guy? I mean, even when Jesus stilled the storms, what did the disciples say? Who is this that even the winds and the waves obey him? I mean, there's reason for us to pause and to ponder and to treasure up things and think about them and let the Holy Spirit just come over us and not just scriptural things, but how about life? How about life? I've watched three daughters and a son get married in just a short time. My son Nathan just got engaged yesterday. Can I tell you a little pondering miracle just between you and I? Many of you know. That my relationship with my kids has been strained, tough. 2 days ago, we celebrated Christmas for the second time. We had a Donnelly Christmas for the second time. And my son Nathan says, "Hey, Dad, would you come? I need to talk to you." And so I followed him, and we went to a room, and he let me know that the next day he was going to get engaged. I know that's no big deal, but you see, 3-4 years ago, I would have found out on Facebook. Somehow God is improving. He's correcting wrongs. He's fixing stuff. He's fixing relationships. He's fixing stuff. Four years ago, our Christmas Eve service had 15 or 20 people in a chiropractor's office. We've moved four times. And although this crowd here doesn't look very big, you add this to 170, 180 people that showed up yesterday, and the Lord's done some pretty cool stuff. And so a pastor sits back and ponders. I have had coffee with many of you because things were just crazy in your lives, or shared hugs, or a text or a phone call. I've watched God heal some of you. I've watched God completely change. Completely change. Some of you right before my eyes. There is so much to ponder. There is so much to treasure up. In the last year, what blindness has he begun to work inside of you to cure? What deafness is he working on so that you might hear him better? What lameness to the body is he working on to bring whole, make new? For some of us, we were dead a year ago, and today we're alive. And I guess every one of us could register in on the dumb will speak the praises of the I am. I certainly didn't mean for this to be a heavy message. I want you to realize that Mary had much to ponder. Again, she's 17 to 19 years old. She's talked to angels and had angels talk to her. She's heard from shepherds that angels had broke the skies and sung, spoke messages about her son that she can't even spend the time to wrap her mind around because she's going to nurse and change this baby. And how do you do it? You see, she's like you and I. She's got a busy life. How do you fit the divine, the sacred, in the midst of all the busyness? How do we merge them together so that we don't miss? So that we're not like William saying one day, oh my gosh, I've let too much go through. I've left too much to go through. I encourage you today and throughout this week, even as you enter back into your busy lives, read this text every day, this Luke chapter 2. And ask it questions. Stop and ponder single words, single phrases. God, why? Why did the angel say that? Why did they say, do not be afraid? And ponder the fact that you do not have to be afraid because of what that child's going to do. Because that child who was born was not born just to deliver Mary, but to deliver you and to deliver me. And that alone, we could spend a lifetime to ponder. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you. Thank you for pondering with me this morning. Stay in that kind of prayerful, meditative mode while we take our offering, and then we're going to transition to communion. Bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we praise and thank you for the many blessings that you give to us each and every day. Receive this portion back as a thank offering. Use it to bring the message of your Son to those who do not know him and to strengthen the faith of those who do. And all God's people said, amen. All right, brothers and sisters in Christ, we're going to go into a time of prayer while they kind of play softly in the background. Here at Firmly Rooted, here's how we do that. One individual, today it's Pastor Dave, he's going to come up and he's going to grab a microphone and do the general prayers. I'm going to come down the step there and I'm going to come down and pray with any of you who feel moved to come. I just want to put my hands on you and pray with you. It doesn't matter whether it's a prayer of praise or whether it's a prayer of need. It doesn't matter. Just come forward. If you feel the Lord tugging you, I'm telling you to come forward. I'll shut off my microphone and pray with all of you while Pastor Dave does the general prayers, and then we'll transition to communion. So bow your heads and come forward if you're moved to do so.
If you're coming forward, don't bow your heads until you get here, so it's safe. Before we start, I just want to get a lay of the land, because I know I talked to a couple of people that are going through very difficult times yesterday. How many of you, this is your first Christmas without a loved one? A mom, a dad, a grandma, a grandpa. Raise your hands. All right. How many of you, this was not your best year? Raise your hands. When Jesus came, it was not the best year. In fact, it was not a great time even after, because there was the slaughter of the innocents with Herod. It was just the fact that there was no room in the inn, just a lot going on. So if it's not a great time for you, it's a great time to pray. Because just as we're celebrating communion, the bread and the wine, which are representative of Christ's body and blood, the lights are a reminder that hope is amongst us, in our midst. Even in dark and difficult times, there's hope. So let's pray. If you have a need and you didn't want to come down, but you just would like maybe some people to gather around you, just slip your hand up a little bit higher than Methodist and a little bit lower than Charismatic, and this should be fine. We should be able to find you. But Father, we come before you today desperate to be reminded that the light shined in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. The darkness does not understand it. The darkness has no power over it. For the light shines and the darkness dispels, disperses, disappears. We come here with a variety of needs. Some of it is financial. Some of it is relational. Some of it is physical. Some of it's emotional. And you are with us in the midst of it. As I always say, at least for the last 6 or 7 months, it's never just you and your finances. It's you, Jesus, and your finances. We are not alone. We are not forgotten. Even when it's cancer, we're getting treatment like Sue Ellen is getting. It is a treatment that we do not go through alone. When we are praying for healing of our family's hearts and the peace for our families, Jesus, you are in the midst of it. You are the Prince of Peace. And you are there when we are crying out, comforting us, breaking down barriers, helping us. So, Father, as we look at the lights, and as maybe we go out tonight and look at lights, or if we just look at the stage and see the lights, may we recognize and be reminded that it is your light, the light of life, that will raise the dead to life, give sight to the blind, hearing to the deaf, speech to the mute, dancing to the lame, and healing to those who are sick with the things of this world. Father, I thank you that you are always available to us, that you will never turn a deaf ear to us, that we do not have to earn an audience with you, but that you have been and will be in our midst. May we make this reality true to each other by being available to listen and to care for each other. And may Firmly Rooted be a place God is not only believed in, but seen. hearts and the way we carry each other's burdens. Help us now, I pray, to remember and to look forward expectantly. For you have come and you will come again, and everything will be made right. In Jesus' name.
Who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
the King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone Him. Raise the song on high, the virgin sings her lullaby. Joy for Christ is born, the babe, the Son of Mary. King whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring Him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary.
Thank you for doing your most powerful work in such humble ways. You think about what you do through the waters of baptism. You think about what you do through the bread and the wine of communion. To think what you do with printed letters on a white piece of paper. What you do with angels talking to shepherds and your son wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Wow. May we ponder. May we ponder the sacredness of the events. May we ponder the sacredness of not the events just of the past, but what about the sacredness of the events of today? And how you continue to interact in our lives. Father, we praise you and we thank you for all that you have done. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's rise and sing our last song. Receive a 6,000-year-old benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. And all God's people said, amen. Please be seated. Merry Christmas. And how about this youth worship team? Boom. Nice job. Just a few announcements for you as we're wrapping up this Christmas morning. If you're new to Firmly Rooted and you'd like to get connected a little bit, you can text WELCOME to that number. And if you want to get fully connected and get all our weekly little newsletter that we send out electronically, then also text LOOP to that number, and you'll get kind of deeper in to what Firmly Rooted has going on. Next. I'm back teaching Bible study. I was on vacation for a while, but so tomorrow, Monday, 7 o'clock in the evening, I'll be teaching the book of Acts again for all of you that started and then we stopped. We're back on, book of Acts, be there. Tuesday morning, same class, same subject, and we'll be doing that on Tuesday morning at 9:30. Next. Don't forget to, if you have Facebook, to do your check-ins. When you check in to the Firmly Rooted Worship page, not Firmly Rooted Ministries page, but Firmly Rooted Worship page, when you check into that page, what you're doing this year or this month is you are providing books for kids. Every month, the receiver of our gifts becomes different. It's been Haiti, it's been food, it's been literacy. Here it is, literacy is books. And so just know that by simply checking in, you're making a difference. Secondly, obviously, every time you check in, somebody in your timeline realizes that you chose to go to Firmly Rooted, and they might ask you why. And that's good for us as we try to reach out to the community. Next. Oh, I like you'd still have that All He Wants for Christmas Is You. That was the message yesterday. So it's going to be on the website. We have all of our messages on the website, daily devotion on the website, firmlyrooted.org. There is no Bible study next Sunday, New Year's Day, just like today. But we are going to worship at 10:15. I told the people who attended last night, so I'll tell you, we're going to enter into a sermon series that's probably going to go all the way to Easter. We're going to dig into the life of Jesus. So we've asked the question, who is this guy? Who is Jesus? Why did he come? Well, we're going to answer the question. So we're going to follow him. So this next Sunday, we're going to watch Jesus get circumcised and meet Simeon and Anna in the temple. We're going to watch him at 12 years old. We're going to confounding the teachers. We're going to watch him begin his ministry, and we're going to take that all the way through Lent and Easter. And so I haven't titled the sermon series yet, but just know it's going to be about Jesus' life, and we're going to dig in there. Next. The women are going to begin their study January 4th. They took a little break around December, but they're going to be digging back at it. So I can't read it, but I think her name is Priscilla Shearer. She is a great Bible study teacher. They're going to be looking at the armor of God, and that's going to be on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. And Chris, just stand up for a second so people can see you. Chris always, she is very active with the worship teams as well as our slides and everything. She's also kind of spearheading at times the Bible study. So you might want to see her or Lisa Bryant, but let them know your involvement. Did you order the books so they can get them from you, or do they go on and get them? Okay, so Laura's goal is to order them this week so you have them by... Okay, good. Very good. Next, is there another one? January 8th. If there are... Firmly Rooted has been blessed. We have new people coming to us every single Sunday. The Lord is doing some great stuff. And so we meet people at different walks of their Christian life. And so there may be people here that need to be baptized. There may be people who want to, you know, join by affirmation of faith, or they might want to, you know, learn more and study with me and get confirmed in the faith. And so on January 8th, we're going to be doing some baptisms for people that need to be baptized, as well as we're going to bring in some people who want to join Firmly Rooted. And so if you're interested in that, Laura, turn around and look back there. That's Laura. Raise your hand, Laura. Laura is my executive assistant, and she keeps me on the straight and narrow. But she will get all the information she needs so that we can do what we need to do on January 8th. Is that the last one? Good. Merry Christmas. I just pray that the service was a blessing to you. I pray that you have some time to sit and ponder. You know, every once in a while, it's good to be a fly on the wall and just kind of watch what you're living instead of living it. Blessings on your day, and have a firmly rooted week. Amen. Thank you. Oh, wait a minute. Tim, did you have an announcement? Sir Tim? I just remembered there was something, and my brain was rattling for it. I'm sorry, everybody. We'll get you one more second. Lisa Wolf.
Lisa Wolf. Thank you, Lisa Wolf. There are many people that help in the administration end of things. I just want to say thank you to everyone for everything that you do. And it's such a blessing to stand up here and see the new faces that come in every week. And I just want to say thank you all. And let's have a quick prayer over here for our pastor for just honoring him.
Amen, amen. Merry Christmas.